You're not going to be bad to me today, are you? Oh my gosh, it's threatening to run office updates on me. I got up in the middle of the night, I heard my computer running when it was supposed to be asleep, and was like, what are you doing? Oh my gosh. So that's why I turned it off. That's why everything I had to restart. Okay, here we go. Proverbs chapter 28, book of Proverbs, as we've said many times. In fact, this is about 28 times or so we've said this. The book of Proverbs is all about wisdom, and wisdom is not about knowing facts. It's about knowing what to do with what you know. It's about knowing when to do it and knowing how to do it. Have you been grasping that as we've been making our way through this? We've been at this now since August. Proverbs are typically short sayings that give wisdom and insight into everyday things. They are intended to help you lead a better life. Are you putting any of these into practice? Has anybody been trying to put these things into practice? Yes, no, yes. One, two, three, all right, woo-hoo! These are not absolute promises. These are not promises that if you do X and Y, then Z will happen, or as they say in South Africa, X, Y, and Z. I changed my Siri voice to, I think, do I have the Australian or British? I think I have British. You've got Australian. And every time it, like my wife works at CBiz, C-B-I-Z, and it calls, you are now approaching C-B-I-Z. So, sorry. Total rabbit trail. I'm going to be doing lots of those today, probably. It's not an absolute promise that if you do these things, this will happen. Like, this is, you follow the secrets here and you're going to have a wealthy life with no problems. No. But these are general principles. And you do these things and you will indeed head in the right direction. It's worth doing. So, Proverbs 28, verse 1. And I wish I could stop on a whole lot more of these. I had a really hard time narrowing this down today because we got communion this morning. I really had a hard time. And so I, on everything that I don't spend time on, dig into it, gang. Read some of the other versions. Dig into this because there's so much in this chapter, and I apologize ahead of time for not stopping on every one and spending half an hour. Verse 1, the wicked flees when no one pursues. But the righteous are bold as a lion. The Message paraphrase says this. The wicked are edgy with guilt, ready to run off when no one's after them. Honest people are relaxed and confident, bold as lions. And let me just drop this little thing on you. You do with it what you want. But learning to live a righteous life, learning to live correctly, gives you courage. Do you struggle with fear? I bet nobody in here struggles with fear. I'm not afraid. Oh yeah, liar. We're all afraid. But friends, you want help with courage? Live a righteous life. The righteous are bold as a lion. Verse 2, because of the transgression of a land, many are its princes, but by a man of understanding and knowledge, right will be prolonged. New Living Translation, when there is moral rot within a nation, its government topples easily, but wise and knowledgeable leaders bring stability. Does that sound applicable to the United States of America? It does, absolutely. It gives you a hint at why we are in such turmoil, and we are completely blind to it. We think it's all about whose party is right and who needs to win and all this kind of stuff. And we think it's about gun control, or it's about immigration, or it's about walls. No, it's about the fact that we have walked away from God. Verse 3, a poor man who oppresses the poor is like a driving rain which leaves no food. I'd love to spend more time on that, sorry. Verse 4, those who forsake the law praise the wicked, but such as keep the law contend with them. Those who forsake the law. The Message paraphrase puts it this way. If you desert God's law, you're free to embrace depravity. If you love God's law, you fight for it, tooth and nail. And I want to camp out on this for just a few minutes. And I'm calling the principle here, I want to kind of discuss just for a minute, the moral compass. The moral compass. A moral compass is how you and I navigate what's right and what's wrong. How should I live? What's right? What's wrong? Which way should I go? Is there a morally right way? Is there a morally wrong way? We each have a moral compass kind of built in. Do you know that you got a, how many of you have iPhones? A few of you, okay. Did you know you got a compass built into your iPhone? Look for it, it's there. You have a compass built into your iPhone. It will look something like this. I just took a little clip off of it. When we were in Jordan 3 years ago, I was pulling it out because I was trying to find where we were on the map, and it even puts GPS coordinates on. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing, the compass. You pull it out and play with it after church. No, don't. That's fine. It's okay. As long as you listen to me. a magnetic compass. You familiar with the Boy Scouts? A magnetic compass. Are they teaching the boys how to buy magnetic compasses? A magnetic compass always points to the north because of magnets, right? And so it helps a sailor, it helps a Boy Scout to navigate with this map or chart, as long as there's no strong magnets nearby. Because if you've got a strong magnet nearby, your magnetic compass is not going to have, it's not going to know which way is north. It's going to point to the magnet. And if you don't know where north is, gang, you're going to be lost. I think in one sense, your iPhone probably makes a better compass because it's not affected by magnets. It's got a higher source. It follows, it tracks, it uses the GPS satellites. So it's probably a little bit better than a magnetic compass because you put a whole magnet next to it and it's not going to turn. It shows you which way is north. In America, our moral compass is all out of whack because of the magnet called public opinion. We have decided as a nation that this is how we know right from wrong, is how many people think it's right and how many people think it's wrong. If enough people think, and follow me, this is important, if enough people think that it's correct to eat cupcakes for breakfast, how many of you vote for that? Come on. Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's healthy to eat. In fact, it's healthy for you to eat cupcakes for breakfast with an inch thick of icing on it. And maybe have cream-filled cupcakes. Now, if we get enough people voting for it, we'll all start eating cupcakes. That's the way our nation works. The problem with this moral compass is that society keeps changing, and so our sense of true north, you map readers, I know nobody reads maps anymore because I got GPS, I got Google to tell me which way I need to go, but our moral compass is off. Because we have this magnet that has turned our sense of direction. Are you following me? It's nothing new. Paul, in his own day, this has happened, he saw this happening when men reject the truth about God. Romans 1:22 says this, claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols. That's an idol, by the way. They worshipped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshipped and served God. They served the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. It is no surprise, my friends, that since we decided as a society to kick God out of our secular culture, that there's no place for God, that we no longer know what's right and what's wrong. Are you following me? I'll bet some of you or your kids have been taught in school that we all need to learn tolerance. Right? We need to learn tolerance. And we need to allow people the freedom to explore their own ideas about sexuality and what is right and what is wrong. And that if we speak against this and call it sin, why, this is hate speech. Does that sound familiar? This is the way our society thinks. We've lost our sense of right and wrong. Do you know how to tell right from wrong? Do you know how to tell right from wrong? The world tells us, trust your heart. I'm going to talk more about this later because it's further on in the passage. But the world tells us, you just need to trust your heart. And so the way that translates into is, sex is okay as long as you love each other. That loving each other makes it okay because I'm just going with my heart. Every romantic movie on this planet follows that. It's okay as long as you love each other. God tells us to trust His word. It doesn't change. It's the satellite form of GPS. It's from a source higher than us. A source that doesn't change. It's the true north of what's right and what's wrong. Moral compass. Moral compass. Those who forsake the law praise the wicked, but such as keep the law contend with them. Verse 5. Evil men do not understand justice, but those who seek the Lord understand all. I'd like to talk about that one, but I'm not. Verse 6, better is the poor who walks in his integrity than one perverse in his ways, though he be rich. Holman Christian Standard Bible says this, better a poor man who lives with integrity than a rich man who distorts right and wrong. There's again this right and wrong stuff, who distorts right and wrong. Verse 7, whoever keeps the law is a discerning son, but a companion of gluttons shames his father. New Living Translation says, young people who obey the law are wise. Those with wild friends bring shame to their parents. See, the problem with wild friends, it's not that you have friends, but the problem is that 1 Corinthians 15:33 says, evil company corrupts good habits. That's the problem. Verse 8, one who increases his possessions by usury and extortion gathers it for him who will pity the poor. New Living Translation says, income from charging high interest rates will end up in the pocket of someone who is kind to the poor. Verse 9, one who turns away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer is an abomination. I had a whole section, but I'm sorry, let's move on. There's a lot there. Verse 10, whoever causes the upright to go astray in an evil way, he himself will fall into his own pit, but the blameless will inherit good. Verse 11, the rich man is wise in his own eyes, but the poor who has understanding searches him out. I like this New Living Translation. Rich people may think they are wise, but a poor person with discernment can see right through them. They can see right through them. Verse 12, when the righteous rejoice, there is great glory, but when the wicked arise, men hide themselves. Verse 13, he who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. I'm going to stop here. I've got to stop here. And the whole principle is to learn to deal with sin. And I don't know if you picked it up, but that's kind of like one of the themes this morning. It's all about sin. This, you know, stay away from sin. Figure out what's right and wrong. Stay away from it. And it's a universal problem, this problem of sin. Because we all, see, the problem is, that's something on, when it comes to stopping and thinking now, how many people will this verse hit? Sometimes I think about that. I think about, is this going to minister to anybody? I'll skip right by it. Maybe two people. This one's going to hit 20 people. I better stop on this one. Well, this one I'm going to have to stop on because we all sin. Every single one of us. You know, this Romans 3:23, for everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. The question is not whether or not you can live your life without sinning. The question is, what will you do once you have sinned? That's the issue. It is certainly in our nature to want to cover up our sin, to want to cover up our imperfections. Adam and Eve were given one rule. That's all they had. Just one little rule. Just don't eat from that one tree. That's it. That's the only rule. Only rule. You can enjoy, you know, the Garden of Eden and everything in it. Just stay away from the one thing. But, you know, they couldn't do that. And so it says in Genesis 3, verse 6, it says, and so when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened. They knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Adam and Eve sinned. And what do? They try to cover it up, just like I do. Just like you do. He who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. Adam and Eve, they tried to sew together fig leaves, and I've been told that not that I've actually tried this, but I've been told that it's not like the most comfortable leaf of the garden to pick, to be wearing against your skin. It's kind of itchy, kind of scratchy. It's like, why did they pick that of everything, you know? Man, oh man, but that's what they picked, fig leaves. And then on top of it, they tried to hide from God, as if you can hide from God. You do that too. I do that too. We try to hide from him. I know one thing that happens is some people kind of drop off of the map when it comes to being in church. You know, I've just blown it too many times. I think I'm going to just stay away. I'm not going to go to the James gang tonight because, like, I just had a bad week. You know, you can't hide from God. He knows exactly what you've done. He's right there with you. God wants us to learn to come to him with our failures and to ask for his help. David wrote, and we think this is around the time of Bathsheba that he writes this. He says, when I refused to confess my sin, my body wasted away and I groaned all day long. Day and night, your hand of discipline was heavy on me. My strength evaporated like water in the summer heat. Finally, I confessed all my sins to you and stopped trying to hide my guilt. I said to myself, I will confess my rebellion to the Lord, and you forgave me. All my guilt is gone. I have to tell you this, to be honest, you are not going to grow and develop as a person if you continue to hide your sin. You're going to have stunted growth. Growth comes from admitting your sin, admitting that you failed, and looking for ways to change. That's how you grow, is by bringing it out into the open. Now, I know that there's something that stops us from doing that. What stops us from admitting our sin? Well, because, you know, I'm going to be in big trouble. You know, she's not going to be with me anymore. She's not going to like me, or he's going to be so upset when he finds out what I did, or things like that go through our head. We're afraid of consequences of admitting our sin. Let me just say this to you. I don't have this one down yet, but I know, and I am learning, that the consequences of my sin are some of the things that help me stay away from it. And when you hide yourself from the consequences, you are keeping yourself from one of your best tools to be able to stay away from sin. Do you hear me? I may not like the fact that she doesn't want to touch me for a week, but you know what? That helps you know that I don't want to ever go down that road again. There may be consequences, but my friend, that may be exactly what you need. And best yet, when I confess my sin, I find mercy from God. And I got to tell you, that is way, way, way better than any consequence that you face. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is why Jesus came, friends. This is why he came. This is why he came to pay the price for our forgiveness. He came to die on a cross. He came to die in my place, in your place, so that God would be just in forgiving you, because he's already paid the price. Don't cover your sins, friend. The price has been paid. Come and find mercy. Verse 14. Happy is the man who is always reverent, but he who hardens his heart will fall into calamity. Verse 15. Like the roaring of a lion and a charging bear is a wicked ruler over poor people. In other words, some people just have like no compassion for the people that they work for. They got like zip, zero compassion. So see, this woman goes to the doctor's office, where she's seen by one of the newer doctors. And after about 4 minutes in the examination room, she bursts out screaming as she runs down the hall. An older doctor stops her and asks what the problem was, and she tells him the story. After listening, he has her sit down and relax in another room. The older doctor marches down the hallway to where the young doctor is, and he says, "What's the matter with you? Mrs. Terry is 63 years old. She has 4 grown children, 7 grandchildren, and you told her she was pregnant?" The new doctor continues to write on his clipboard, and without even looking up, he says, "But does she still have hiccups?" That was like a joke. Yeah. Thank you. Brownie points for you, Stephanie. All right. Look, as some people have no compassion. Verse 16. A ruler who lacks understanding is, and I meant not for your having compassion on me, I meant your compassion on the doctor. Okay. A ruler who lacks understanding is a great oppressor, but he who hates covetousness will prolong his days. New Living Translation says, a ruler with no understanding will oppress his people, but one who hates corruption will have a long life. I that's a good spin on that. Verse 17, a man burdened with bloodshed will flee into a pit. Let no one help him. Verse 18, whoever walks blamelessly will be saved, But he who is perverse in his ways will suddenly fall. Verse 19, he who tills his land will have plenty of bread, but he who follows frivolity will have poverty enough. New Living Translation says, a hard worker has plenty of food, but a person who chases fantasies ends up in poverty. There's a principle here that's true, whether it's in the workforce or whether it's even in school. Maybe even in school. Pay attention here, those of you who are in school. Students, you will be taking lots of classes about things that you will tell yourself do not matter in life. How in the world does algebra help me in life? You're wanting me to ask this. I think those of you students want me to ask this. Okay, adults, how many of you use algebra in everyday life? Liar. No, you don't. No, it's worthless. It's worthless. You don't need to know algebra. But see, we tell ourselves stuff like that, don't we? I'm teasing you. We tell ourselves like this, stuff like this. And so what do? We go off and say, oh, I don't care about it. I'll just go play a game. Fantasies. The subject matter isn't always the same. Sometimes it's learning the discipline. Sometimes the whole thing is about this. Will you learn the discipline of working hard, whether you think it matters or not? So that's the point here. He who tills his land will have plenty of food. There's going to be plenty of times in life, whether it's school or whether it's at work, where you're thinking it's no big deal, I should just let this go. You know what? You work hard. You work hard. You're going to find blessings at the end of that. Verse 20, a faithful man will abound with blessings, but he who hastens to be rich will not go unpunished. The Message paraphrase says this, committed and persistent work pays off. Get-rich-quick schemes are rip-offs. Don't go for the get-rich-quick schemes. Verse 21, to show partiality is not good, because for a piece of bread a man will transgress. The Message paraphrase says this, playing favorites is always a bad thing. You can do great harm in seemingly harmless ways. That's partiality, is playing favorites. Verse 22, a man with an evil eye hastens after riches and does not consider that poverty will come upon him. A man with an evil eye, Some people have this notion that an evil eye, that's a kid's perfecting the evil eye. And people have this notion, how it's creeped into our culture, that it's either you're casting an evil spell by looking at somebody with, he's got the evil eye. In the Bible, this is where it comes from, is the Bible. The evil eye has nothing to do with, it's not about casting spells. It's about wanting something that doesn't belong to you. I have an evil eye because I'm wanting what's not mine. I'm wanting what's yours. That's the evil eye. And we call that greed. And the simple lesson is this, gang. Greed is bad. Jesus said it was more blessed to give than to receive. While the world tells you, get all you can. 1987, the movie was called Wall Street. Was about people who love money.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated. In the last 7 deals that I've been involved with, there were 2.5 million stockholders who have made a pre-tax profit of $12 billion. Thank you. I am not a destroyer of companies. I am a liberator of them. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
But see, there are plenty of people in this world that live by that, that actually think that greed is good. They live their lives by this philosophy. From what I understand, I've never seen the movie, but I just, that's one, greed is good. That's just a clip. I had to show this. Greed is good. I understand that Michael Douglas's character ends up arrested and ends up in prison. I think it comes after the movie because the second, I can think they made the sequel and he's getting out of prison. Poverty came on him. Greed is not good. The world lives on this. The world works on this, but not you. Greed is bad. Jesus said our lives should be aimed at something other than getting more stuff. He said in Matthew 6:33, which is a whole passage, I encourage you, extra credit, read Matthew chapter 6. You'll hear there's a verse in there where Jesus talks about the evil eye. He talks about if your eye is bad, that's the evil eye, and it's all about money. And at the end of the chapter, he says, seek first the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. Put your priorities on him first. Verse 23, he who rebukes a man will find more favor afterward than he who flatters with a tongue. That was another great gem right there. Verse 24, whoever robs his father or his mother and says, it is no transgression, the same is a companion to a destroyer. New Living Translation, anyone who steals from his father and mother and says, what's wrong with that, is no better than a murderer. Verse 25, he who is of a proud heart stirs up strife, but he who trusts in the Lord will be prospered. Verse 26, he who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but whoever walks wisely will be delivered. We'll come back to that in a minute. Verse 27, he who gives to the poor will not lack, but he who hides his eyes will have many curses. That's another one that could be expanded. Verse 28, when the wicked arise, men hide themselves, but when they perish, the righteous increase. Or another paraphrase, when corruption takes over, good people go underground, but when the crooks are thrown out, it's safe to come out. Pray for that day. Okay, let's go back to verse 26 and we'll end here. He who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but whoever walks wisely will be delivered. He who trusts in his own heart, and that's the point here, trusting in your own heart. I found a great clip. This is 1957. Dean Martin made a movie titled 10,000 Bedrooms. He's a hotel owner. And in this movie, he gives us this wise piece of advice. 1957.
The stars may deceive you, may vanish and leave you. Be smart, only trust your heart. The breeze softly sighs, in truth may be lying. Be smart, only trust your heart. The warmth of her kisses may teach you what bliss is, but this is a faithless lover's art. trust your eyes, not the firelight that comes from the starlight. Be smart, only trust your heart.
What a great song, Only Trust Your Heart, right? I don't see too many. Well, I thought it was a great clip. Sorry. Movies have long admonished us to trust our heart. Is it a wise thing? When you ask someone for advice, sometimes people will say to you, they will say these words, "What does your heart tell you?" Have you heard that phrase before? What does your heart tell you? Here's another clip. Lord of the Rings.
No news of Frodo. No word. Nothing.
We have time. Every day Frodo moves closer to Mordor.
Do we know that?
It is.
What does your heart tell you?
Now, in the movies, the heart's always right. So they tell you, trust your heart. The problem is that in real life, our hearts or our emotions change quite often. Sometimes it depends on what you had for dinner last night. Oh, I've got a bad feeling about this. Or is it the heartburn? Is it the pizza you just had? Don't put so many anchovies on that pizza. Oh, I got a bad feeling about this. I mean, there's a Han Solo line. I got a bad feeling about this, you know. Jeremiah wrote, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" Solomon advises against trusting in the heart. Instead, you need to learn to lean on wisdom. He says, "He who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but whoever walks wisely will be delivered." It means that you make your decisions in life on things bigger than your heart, because you have no way of knowing if your heart is leading you astray, away from the good path, away from the right path. The best input, gang, that we can trust to navigate through life is not our heart, which changes, but it's God's Word, the true compass, which doesn't change. Psalm 119, verse 160, "The entirety of your word is truth, and every one of your righteous judgments endures forever." We ought to be paying attention, gang, not to what the heart says, but what does God's Word say? See, sometimes I don't want to quite do that because God's Word might be leading me to go down a path that's just a little bit more difficult than I want to go down. That might be what you need to do. Well, I shouldn't say it might be. I'm being nice to you. It is what you need to do. Be careful about trusting your heart. And with that, let's have communion. Is that okay with you? Do you mind if we have communion? I get the guys who are going to help with communion to come up and get things ready. And while they are doing that, how about if you and I spend a minute or two in prayer and getting our hearts ready? Lord, I would like to pray for any of us here this morning who might be struggling, wrestling, maybe even fighting against some of the things that we've talked about this morning. I would pray, Lord, for any of my dear friends here who are struggling with sin and guilt and shame in their life. And they're trying to keep it together by keeping things covered up. I pray, Lord, that this morning they might peel off a couple of layers and to expose their heart to you. Friend, maybe you've never opened your heart to Jesus at all. You need Him. You need Him. And I would dare say that you actually are aware of that, that you know that you need Him. Let this be the day that right now you say, God, I have sinned. And I've blown it. You see this thing that I've done. And I'm not going to hide it from you anymore. God, could you forgive me? Would you forgive me? Would you make me your child? And give me your mercy. Help me to turn from my sin, to forsake it, and have strength to do that. I'm so thankful that you are a God of mercy. In Jesus' name, amen.